You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the live garden show where we talk about everything about gardens in California, really the Western United States. We talk about everything from trees to turf and from apples to zinnias. Today, we're going to be focusing on aloes and agaves, but we'll be talking about some other succulent materials that you can use in your garden if you choose to get rid of your lawn and go to a dry or a low water use landscape. We'll be talking about a lot of those kinds of plants today. Our phone number is 1-800-339-1193. Give us a call. If you have a question about your garden, if you've got a pest in your garden, you want to figure out how to control it. If you've got some plant material you want to talk about, or call up and talk about how successful your garden's been, anything you want to talk about, give us a call. You can also email us at that email address you just saw there. So give us a call, and we'll be looking at a bunch of different stuff today. And if you haven't seen the show before, I'm a plant pathologist and a certified arborist. I've been working in the landscape industry for close to 40 years, so it's been a long time, and I've got a little bit of experience to talk about plant materials. So let's go on to our upcoming events, which is what we always start the show with. We've got a number of upcoming events we want to talk about today. Because we're winding down the semester. This is our next to last show. Next week will be our last show until the fall when we'll be back on the air. So let's talk about some upcoming events you can schedule on your calendar to get out and enjoy our wonderful Southern California weather and learn something about landscapes and plant materials. Our first event is the Spring Topia. This is at the Los Angeles County Arboretum on Saturday, May 3rd and Sunday, May 4th. The Arboretum will celebrate a world of plants at the two-day Springtopia. Highlights include Wild Flowering LA exhibit and a host of learning opportunities and outdoor fun. Their outstanding staff at the Arboretum will show you the best plants and gardening techniques for Southern California. Topics will include vegetable gardens, orchid trees, drought-resistant plants, and heritage roses. So give them a call or plan to attend. This is their spring sale event where they'll have booths and nurseries will set up booths, and there'll be a lot of unique plant materials that you can take home and enjoy for many years to come. In addition to that, we have the Open Days Program Garden Tour in Beverly Hills, Saturday, May 10th from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. at Greystone Mansion. You will explore six private gardens in Beverly Hills, open to the public for self-guided tours to benefit the Garden Conservancy. Highlights include a white entry garden filled with roses, Mediterranean, Australian, and California natives, and a property combining a traditional cottage garden and tropical retreat. Map and tickets will be available at Greystone Mansion in Beverly Hills from 9:30 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. Gardens open 10 to 4. Admission to each garden is $7 or $35 for a booklet of six tickets. Children under 12 are free, no reservations required. So put that on your calendar. That would be really an exciting thing to attend. In addition to that, we have the annual Epiphyllum pre-sale, which is rather timely because I have some Epiphyllums to show you today. So this will be at the Los Angeles County Arboretum on Saturday, May 17th from 9 to 4. And you can treat yourself to an enjoyable time viewing these unusual and gorgeous flowers and learning more about them. And we'll talk a little bit about them today because it's a wonderful plant material that needs actually a lot less water than some people think. They do respond to good water, but we'll talk about those more in a minute. In addition to the Epiphyllum pre-sale, we have the Santa Barbara Cactus and Succulent Society's annual show and sale. Santa Barbara Cactus and Succulent Society's mission is to provide opportunities for fellowship and exchange of information among persons sharing an interest in succulents, to encourage, promote, and support all aspects of the responsible collection, culture, study, and conservation of succulent plants, and to provide opportunities for the exchange and exhibition of succulent plants. This is one of the best events on the Central Coast and takes place every year in the spring. Potting demonstrations will be at 11. It's free admission. This is at the Lutheran Evangelical Church in Santa Barbara, California. For more information, visit sbcactus.org/sbcss. And I'm sure you can find that on the internet just by Googling Santa Barbara Cactus and Succulent Society and taking a look at their calendar. So a great opportunity to find some unique cactus and succulents and meet people of like interest. In addition to that, we have the Sustainable Home and Garden Show, Saturday, May 17th and May 18th at Los Rios Park, San Juan Capistrano. A variety of workshops, resources, and speakers will be available between 9 and 4 on both days, with a focus on plants, edible landscape, habitat gardens, and a variety of workshops. So this ought to also highlight a lot of drought-tolerant materials, as well as vegetable gardening and fruit trees. In addition to that, we also have the Rose Festival at Descanso Gardens in La Cañada, Flintridge, Sunday, May 25th, from 10:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. Everything is coming up roses in this new festival, which celebrates this favorite flower, free with admission. Get the scoop on rose gardening, from the best way to care for plants to new varieties to try at home. Floral artist Allison Franchi and makeup artist Jennifer Aspinall will turn a model into a living piece of art decorated with roses, body paint, and jewels. Allison Franchi of La Petite Gardenia will demonstrate creating lovely arrangements with roses. The California Shakespeare Ensemble will present a spirited reading of Shakespeare's comedy. Join this guided walk and learn what's new in the International Rosarium. And of course, they have an excellent collection of roses at the Descanso Gardens in La Cañada, in addition to a wonderful camellia forest and a wonderful garden overall. So that's all our upcoming events. Now, I just last Saturday gave a lecture to the Master Gardeners program for Los Angeles County, which is a part of Common Ground, which is run by Yvonne Savio. And for many years, I've gone and given a two-hour lecture as part of their training. And if you're not familiar with Master Gardeners in Los Angeles County, it is a volunteer organization. And in order to go through their training, you have to apply. They only take about 50 volunteers every spring. It is every Saturday for 8 hours for about 4 months. It totals nearly 100 hours of training to become a Master Gardener. And then you're required to volunteer and set up gardens at various locations, either at schools or community gardens. There's a lot of different ways to volunteer through the Master Gardener program. It's a wonderful program, and it's part of Common Ground. And the purpose of Common Ground in Los Angeles County is to assist low-income communities with better nutrition, to grow their own food and understand how to grow their own food, control the pests. And so the Master Gardeners go out and help people set up community gardens, help schools set up school gardens, things like that. And they participate in many, many ways in assisting the community with gardens. But they had this really interesting little wheel, and I want to show it to you. This is from the University of California Cooperative Extension. And let's take a look at this and go to the overhead. I thought this was kind of a nice little setup. And so here we got it right here in front of us. And so here's the picture that you take a look at, and you can see a snail in here. And then it tells you the name of the pest name. It says snails and slugs under plants and on leaves and fruit. And if you come down here, it tells you the damage, irregular holes in leaves and flowers and fruit, hand picking, and how least toxic control, hand picking, trap boards, copper barriers, iron phosphate baits. And so that works pretty good. Another good way to control snails is to put cans, berry coffee cans or some type of can in the soil, and they will tend to go down inside the can during the daytime. At night, they'll come out when it's cool and moist and feed, but then before sunup, they will go and hide places. And they like, if you put a can in the ground, maybe a coffee can, and you bury it to its rim, they'll go down in the can, and then during the day, you can just scoop them out of the can and discard them or crush them or whatever you want to do. But if we just turn this wheel, we take a look at a different pest. This one, if you notice this pest in your garden, and this is a little white fly, it says, what are it? It's white flies. We've talked about white flies. And where do you find it? Undersides of leaves. And the damage, distortion, or discoloration of leaves. Honeydew attracts ants and promotes the growth of sooty mold. Least toxic control, encourage beneficial insects, control ants, remove infested leaves or plants. Horticultural soaps and oils, wash with strong stream of water. All very good advice, but I just thought this was a nice little wheel, and I'm not sure what you'd pick one up, but I got one at the Master Gardener training because I wanted to share it with you. So that's kind of nice. And on the backside, it's in Spanish. So from the University of California Cooperative Extension, really excellent little tool to help gardeners identify pests and find the least toxic means to control them. Now let's take a look at a few other things that I brought in today. This one is kind of new for me. I'd heard about it in the past. And, you know, my day job is I'm a plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner. I have a plant diagnostic lab in Southgate. And our services are free to the community. We do disease diagnosis, weed ID, insect identification. We do a lot of stuff. But this came in, and this is called a pitaya, or dragon fruit. It's actually a cactus, and there's three different species of cactus that are commonly referred to as dragon fruit. And so these are cuttings of the cactus, and the actual cactus is Hylocerus. The genus is Hylocerus, and there's three species, Hylocerus undatus, Hylocerus costriacensis, and Hylocerus megalophansis. So there's three different species, and we'll talk about them briefly here. Now what happens, you get these big red fruit, and they're called dragon fruit, and they're supposed to be very, very delicious and very rather expensive. And unlike a lot of cactus, instead of having big, huge thorns or spines all over the edges of the leaves, these just have little tufts, you know, where you would normally have the spines, you just have little tufts of hairs. I guess it's hard to see them, but they're actually quite small, so that's kind of nice. So here you can see here there's some little tiny thorns. They're kind of soft, they're more like hairs than they are thorns. So that's nice in a way. It makes it a lot easier to handle. You don't get poked and get holes in all your hand all over the place. So let's take a look at what these actually look like. If we could go to my screen, and we'll take a quick look at Wikipedia, one of my favorite websites. And let's go to, if we can bring my screen up on the big screen. Here it is. And here is the fruit. These are dragon fruit. This is the fruit that's produced by this cactus. And these range about, I was told, $5 a piece in some of the stores, like some of the markets in Monterey Park. And here's what it looks like when it grows. You can see the fruit developing here. So this is a really fun cactus to grow. It's not going to take a whole lot of water. It's not like some of the other cactus. You do need to water it a little bit if you want to get a lot of fruit. Now I just want to click on Hylocerus undatus right here. This is the most common one sold as dragon fruit, and take a look at the flower. And there's the flower. You see, it's a typical cactus flower, you know, really showy, you know, more stamens than you can count. Here's the pistil. And so that's the female part, the male part. These are the petals, here are the sepals. This is kind of typical of a cactus bloom, really showy. And if you look down here, you can see how showy it can actually be. So not only does it make a wonderful fruit that's delicious and fairly expensive, it puts on a big show when it flowers. So that's it's referred to as pitaya. And if I click on pitaya here, you can see here's pitaya. And now there's three different species. And undulatus has a red rind and white meat. And the costriacensis has a red-skinned fruit with a red flesh, and the megalanthus has a yellow skin and white flesh. So there's three different species you could grow. And I may, in fact, have all three here, because in the box that I got these out of, they're marked A, B, and C. So I'm hoping I actually have all three species, and these are quite easy to grow. Come on back to me. Great. All you have to do, these are already dried up. When you make a cutting of a cactus, especially a cactus like this, these is also very similar to epiphyllum. And we'll look at those in a minute. But you cut it off, you cut a piece off, let this dry for a few days up to a couple weeks. You could even let it sit around for months. It's not necessary to do that, but it'll look, just look like this. It won't change a bit after a month or two. But you stick this into a pot, well-drained soil. You can use a cactus mix. But if you use a cactus mix, I would actually cut it about 50% with perlite or maybe vermiculite, something to increase drainage. And it would probably be a good idea to perhaps grow it in a clay pot rather than a plastic pot. And then just stick it in there and maybe support it with something so it doesn't tip over. And it will readily root and it'll take off, it'll bloom, and then you'll get some wonderful, wonderful fruit. So that's Pattaya. Hyloceris is the genus. And we'll just set these to the side. And now we'll talk a little bit about epiphyllum, because I mentioned on our upcoming events that there is the epiphyllum plant sale coming up at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. Epiphyllum is one of the most wonderful cactus you can grow. I've got quite a few in my garden, and some of them I've got names on them, and others I don't. Here is, let's go to the overhead. Let's go to the overhead because I can show it pretty easily here. And often I don't get a chance to bring these in because they're not blooming during the show. And if they had bloomed a couple weeks later, I wouldn't have been able to bring it in. So here's a nice, wonderful, white blooming epiphyllum. Now, epiphyllum have these flat stems or leaf-like stems, and they bloom in the nodes. These flowers usually only last a day or two, and then they wither away. But they're spectacular when they bloom. Typical kind of a cactus flower, very showy, with numerous stamens and the pistil there in the middle. These will actually, if you cross them, you'll get seed. You'll get a big fruit on them, and you'll get seed. And if you want, you can cross them and get your own seedlings. And they'll be different. If you cross it with a different colored flower, you'll get something different. And we talked about epiphyllum before. Here's another epiphyllum. Let's go to the overhead and take a look at this one. And again, I don't know, I don't have names for you. Sorry, I don't have cultivated varieties. Now, a lot of the epiphyllums you get are actually hybrids with other genera, not necessarily purely epiphyllum or species epiphyllums, but they're almost certainly mostly hybrids. But you can see the vibrant color you get in these. They come in yellow, pink, white, you know, red, orange. There's just a many, and there's many, many named varieties. So if you go to the sale at the Arboretum coming up in May, you'll be able to purchase them and maybe keep track of the names better than I do. But over the years, people have given me cuttings. They didn't know the name. I don't, in a way, I'm growing it because I love the plant. I didn't, not because I love the name. So I'm not going to stop growing it just because I lost track of the name. But I may take some of these with me, get some pictures and share them with some friends, see if they recognize them. But that's not likely because a lot of them are very, very similar. I'll leave this sitting out. I don't really have a mystery plant today. So that's everything I brought to share with you in terms of actual plant material. But today we're going to talk about aloes and agaves, and they're very similar. Aloes and agaves look very much the same because they usually grow as a rosette, which means the leaves are all in a rosette. And I'll show you exactly what I mean by a rosette. This is actually an aeonium. It's not an aloe or an agave. But you can see here, if we go maybe to this camera over here, Now this one's called Aeonium atropurpureum, and this is, or it's, the cultivar is actually called Schwarzkopf. It's so dark and black, but this is a rosette of leaves, and so aloes and agaves typically grow as rosettes. The leaves are in a rosette, and so they can be very similar to each other, and I got a couple aloes to show you, but let's start off by talking about agaves. There are native agaves to the southwestern United States and Mexico, and they make wonderful landscape plant materials. And of course, what we've been talking about over the last few weeks, particularly, is getting rid of your lawn, getting rid of plant materials that require frequent irrigation, and nothing requires more irrigation than a lawn. Lawns typically will use 3 to 4 feet of water per year in a hot inland valley, a little less than that maybe down at the beach, and even more than that down out in the desert. And lawns are really an element of what you would call an English garden. And of course, English gardens are lush and green and wonderful, but not particularly appropriate for Southern California. And so we should move away from lawns. We're in the midst of a record drought. We don't have a lot of water. The cost of water every year is going up and up and up for households. My water bill seems to get bigger every year, even though I have actually used less water every year. So you can get rid of your lawn, save yourself a lot of water, and save yourself money, and have a more interesting landscape. I tell you, lawns are kind of boring. So why not put in some interesting plant material, watch them bloom, watch the birds and the hummingbirds, the various butterflies or moths they'll attract. So let's talk about agave. Agave are chiefly Mexican species. Agaves are also native to the southern and western United States, central and tropical South America. And they are not cacti. They are succulents, and they have a large rosette of thick, fleshy leaves, each ending generally in a sharp point with a spiny margin. The stout stem is usually short, the leaves apparently springing from the root. Each rosette is what we call monocarpic, and I've mentioned that term before. Monocarpic means that it blooms once and then it dies. They grow slowly to flower only once. During flowering, a tall stem or mast grows from the center of the leaf rosette and bears a large number of short tubular flowers. After development of fruit, which will be the seed capsules, the original plant dies, but many of them will sucker from the base, producing new plants. Although some agaves don't do that. The whole plant dies and then the seed comes up where the plant was in order to maintain the plant material itself. And of course, it is a common misconception that agaves are cacti, but they are not at all. Their flowers are wholly different. They're not even particularly related to cacti, nor are they closely related to aloe, which is the other genus we're going to talk about today. And aloes, of course, are very similar in appearance. So let's take a look at our first picture, number one. This is a hybrid called shark skin. Bring that up full screen. I want to talk about the basic characteristics of agaves. And the tips of the leaves are very sharp and like a spine. And of course, here's your rosette of leaves, but particularly the tips are very, very sharp tipped, the tips of the leaves. The other thing is if you bend the leaf back, it's fibrous and it doesn't break. So those are the two most important characteristics that you can use to distinguish between an agave and an aloe, because aloes don't have sharp tips on their leaves and they don't, and when you bend an aloe, it will snap, it's brittle and it breaks. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is agave blue glow. This is another hybrid agave. But you can see the very sharp tips of the leaves. And many of the agaves have a very blue color to them. Let's take a look at agave javadriana, which is our next picture. And this particular species, Javadriana, is medium to large size century plant. Many of these are referred to as century plants, native to the rocky grassland slopes from West Texas to Mexico, usually occurring between 4,000 and 6,000 foot elevation. It forms 3 to 4 foot wide, single rosette, rarely offsetting. This is one that once it blooms, and this one is actually blooming. Here's the flower spike. So after this blooms, this whole plant will die. But it takes many years for it to bloom. So a single rosette of thick spiny leaves to 20 inches long and 6 inches wide, a very hardy species that's protected from winter moisture when temperatures fall below 20. Specimens are topped with stunningly massive 12 foot tall asparagus looking flower spikes in summer. So this is a particularly nice one, but you have to remember agaves do die out many times. Now, if we take a look at our next picture, this is agave quinquingola. This distinctive agave is native to Cerro Quinquingola, a limestone mountain in the southern Mexican state of Oaxaca. It grows on a sheer cliff faces in prodigious numbers, resembling dense colonies of sea stars. There is some variation in leaf size and color, predictably an offsetting clone that lends itself to propagation. It's become the most widely distributed form in cultivation, and as it happens, it has light green foliage. The clone offered here has been solitary for most of its life in the Huntington's Desert Garden and is striking for its massive, ghostly pale glaucous leaves. It also a historically and scientifically significant collection because it was made by Howard Gentry and contributed to his description of the species. Only in recent years have a few offsets been produced, allowing it to be photographed and propagated by tissue culture. Rooted offsets from the Huntington collected by Gentry are often sold at their plant sales. So that's a unique species, and it may be a little bit more difficult to find. The next one I want to show you talk about is Agave desertii, but let's actually talk about the regular Agave americana, the century plant. That's our next picture. So let's bring that up full screen. Now this is probably the most common agave you're going to see growing around Southern California. They naturalize pretty easily. I see them up in Eaton Canyon, and they're planted there probably close to 100 years ago, and they're still there because they keep seeding themselves in and they naturalize. So this is called Agave americana, commonly known as a century plant, or sometimes called American aloe, although that's an unfortunate name because it's not an aloe, and it's in a different family. Originally from Mexico, but cultivated worldwide as an ornamental, it has since naturalized in many regions and grows wild in Europe, South Africa, India, and Australia, and Southern California. The misnamed century plant typically lives 10 to 30 years. It has a spreading rosette, about 4 meters or 13 feet wide, of gray-green leaves up to 2 meters long. That's about 6.6 feet long, each with a spiny margin and a heavy spike at the tip that can pierce to the bone. So I don't know if you can see the sharp tips, but that's another, like I said, that's an indicator that this is an agave. When it flowers, and it can take 10 to 30 years to bloom, the spike with big yellow flowers may reach up to 26 feet in height. Its common name likely derives from its nature of flowering only once at the end of its long life. The plant dies after flowering but produces suckers or adventitious shoots from the base which continue its growth. It also seeds in like crazy because that flower spike will shoot up and make thousands of little black seeds, and they come up all over the place. Now, there's a variety of cultivars of this. Originally, this was described by Carl Linnaeus in the 1753 edition of Species Plantarum with the binomial name that we still use today, which is really quite remarkable. Usually they get changed. Let's talk about some of the cultivated varieties and bring this next picture up, number 6. This is marginata with yellow stripes along the margins of each leaf. So really quite striking and really, really lovely. The next one is Mediopicta alba, and that's the one you see here. This is a cultivar of Agave americana. And there is another one that I don't have a picture of, which is Mediopicta ara with a central yellow band. So instead of this white band here, it would be yellow. And that's called Mediopicta aria. Now, there's a striata with multiple yellow white stripes along the leaves and a variegata with white stripes on the leaves. Now, this plant is actually can be used for culinary purposes. If the flower stem is cut without flowering, a sweet liquid called agua mille or honey water gathers in the heart of the plant. This may be fermented to produce a drink called pulque. The leaves also yield fibers known as pita, which are suitable for making rope, matting, coarse cloth, and are used for embroidery of leather in a technique known as pitido. Pitido, I'm probably pronouncing that wrong. Both pulque and maguey fiber were important to the economy of pre-Columbia Mexico. Mezcal and tequila are different from pulque in that they are distilled spirits. In the region of tequila, agaves are called mezcals, and the high alcohol product for this solution is called mezcal. Tequila is made from agave tequiliana, commonly called blue agave. Mezcal may contain the mezcal worm, which pulque and tequila do not. Agave nectar, also called agave syrup, is marketed as a natural sugar substitute with a low glycemic index that is due to its high fructose content. The plant figures in the coat of arms of Don Diego de Mendoza, a Native American grower of the village Ajacuba in the Hidalgo state. The sap is quite acidic and can be quite painful if it comes in contact with the skin. It can form small blisters. And in fact, when removing this plant, if you've got one that comes up in your yard and you don't want it anymore, before it died and you cut it down, you don't even have to get the sap on you. It can cause your skin to develop large red patches that itch like crazy. I'm speaking from experience. So one day I was cutting out one that was growing in a hedge, and it must have gotten there from seed. And it was just in the wrong spot, so I decided it needed to be pulled out, so I started cutting off the leaves. And within minutes, I broke out in rashes all over my body, all over my upper chest. And I had to go stand in the shower for about 30 minutes in a cold shower to get it to stop itching. Those red patches that developed all over my upper body were there for about 2 or 3 days, but they only itched briefly, and so I was able to kind of deal with it. But so be very careful when you're working with the agave americana, the century plants, because the sap can be quite an irritant and cause a pretty decent rash. If you actually get it on your skin, you'll probably blister. Now the next agave we want to talk about is agave desertii. And let's take a look at this. And this is nice because it really shows the flower stalk. Bring this up. So here's the flower spike coming up, and here are all the flowers up here, and it's going to make a lot of seed. This one, the desert agave, is an agave native to the desert regions of Southern California, Arizona, and Baja California. It's tall, yellow flower stalks dot dry, rocky slopes and washes throughout the spring. Forms a rosette of fleshy gray-green leaves, 20 to 70 centimeters long and 4.5 to 10 centimeters broad, with sharp spines at the edges and on the edges and at the tips. It flowers at maturity, which would probably be 20 to 40 years. Sending up an inflorescence 2 to 6 meters tall, the panicle bears numerous yellow funnel-shaped flowers. There are actually two varieties of desertii. The variety desertii plants usually with numerous rosettes, and that only occurs naturally in Southern California. And variety simplex plants usually with one or only a few rosettes, Southern California and Arizona. Now, our next one we want to look at is agave attenuata. And let's bring that picture up. Agave attenuata is kind of a unique species within the genus agave because it really doesn't have sharp tips on the ends of the leaves. These tips are soft. They won't poke you. And the leaf is quite soft and tender, actually. Its common name is lion's tail or swain's necks or even foxtail for its development of a curved stem, usually unusual among agaves, native to the plateau of central Mexico as one of the unarmed agaves. It is popular as an ornamental plant in gardens throughout the world, really. The stems typically range from 50 to 100 centimeters, that'd be 20 to 60 inches in length, and eventually old leaves fall off, leaving them naked and visible. The leaves are ovate acuminate, and that's what that is right there. This is ovate acuminate. And they are 20 to 28 inches long and 5 to 6 inches wide, pale in color, ranging from a light gray to a light yellowish green. There are no teeth nor terminal spines, although the leaves taper to points that fray with age. Their inflorescence is a dense raceme, 8 to 10 feet high, with greenish yellow flowers. And let's take a look at the next picture, and it'll show you one of those flowers. This is when they're really put on a show, is when they bloom. Let's take a look at number 10, and you can see those flowers. The original specimens were sent to Kew by the explorer Galietti in 1834 from an unspecified location in central Mexico. More recent study has reported it from Jalisco east to Mexico, in small colonies of elevation to 1,900 to 2,500 meters. That's up to 5,000 feet, which is substantial. So they should tolerate a little bit of frost, but they are a little tender. This one will freeze. If we get down into the 20s, this will freeze. You'll get frost damage. There have been few sightings suggesting this agave is rare in the wild, but it is widely cultivated, so it's easily available. Let's see if we have photograph number 10 showing the flowers on agave attenuata. Hopefully we do, because that's, here we go, bring that up full screen. Just want to show you how it blooms. This is quite unusual for agaves. Usually agaves send up a real straight inflorescence, just like that. This one, it bends over and does this. And here's another one. Now, the rosette, where this is coming out of, will die, but, and this one is actually, this is at the Huntington Botanical Gardens. This is their, this is the wall along the road that leads down to the desert garden. So here they are blooming, but they will send up new plants at the base of the old plants that die. Now, one of my favorite agaves is Agave Victoria Regina. That's our next picture. And it's, this is called Queen Victoria's agave. It is a small species noted for its streaks of white on sculpted geometrical leaves and popular as, very popular as an ornamental. Name for Queen Victoria. This agave is highly variable in form, but in general the rosettes are small and compact. Short, rigid, thick leaves that are green with a pattern of distinctive white markings. And you can see the white edges on the leaves right along here. Very, very sharp spines at the tip. They'll poke you and you'll bleed if you're not careful. The markings are generally along the leaf keels or margins, giving a short polyhedral appearance. Marginal teeth are usually lacking, while the terminus of the leaf may include 1 to 3 spines. So, you know, typical agave is found across the Chihuahuan Desert with about half a dozen subspecies named. The situation is complicated by hybrids with a number of other agave species. Cold hardy as agaves go, and thus finds favor as a small accent in many northerly gardens. This will actually take quite a bit of cold. Now our next agave is agave Swai. And let's take a look at that. That's our next photograph. And you can see this one really has a lot of teeth right along the margins. Very sharp tips right there. Occasionally called Shah's agave, found along the Pacific coast of Baja California, extending north into the coastal chaparral of southernmost California. So this is a California native. That's nice. At least, you know, actually Baja California, from a botanical standpoint, is part of the California Floristic Province, and anything growing in Baja is really native to Southern California. I mean, just because we have a border down there at San Diego doesn't mean the plants have to respect it. This is a small to medium agave with green ovate leaves, 20 to 50 centimeters long and 8 to 20 centimeters wide, variable pattern of marginal teeth. Inflorescences form a panicle 2 to 4 meters in height, whose 8 to 14 lateral umbels, and those are flowers actually, are subtended by large purple bracts. Each umbel consists of a mass of yellow or reddish flowers. Flowers February to May, and as typical for agaves, the rosette dies thereafter. Although capable of reproducing by suckering, populations vary considerable in their behavior, with some consisting entirely of individual rosettes, while others form groups and colonies or clones. So agave Swai, or Shawii, may die out, and you would have to, you know, start getting new ones. And they're not cheap plants. Let me tell you, when you go buy an agave in a 5-gallon or even in a small pot, they're fairly expensive. They're not the fastest growing plants. And so when you buy a big one, they're kind of expensive. And so think about that. It's going to be in your garden for 5 to 10 years, and then it's going to die. And hope so you might want to pick some that produce a pups or smaller plants off the base when the main rosette dies. Now I have a little video, before we continue on with the rest of my agaves, let's go to my video from that's all about agaves, and this is a really nice video giving you a lot of good agave suggestions for your garden. So get a pencil and paper so you can write down these species names when you see one that you're particularly interested in. This is going to repeat some of the ones I just mentioned. But let's take a look at our first video clip, How to Grow Succulents Agaves.
Agaves are native to the southwest in Mexico. Depending on the variety, leaves may be several inches to several feet long. Agaves have crisp silhouettes that look great in front of boulders and walls. Large agaves make excellent garden focal points. Diminutive agaves are ideal for pots and for massing in garden beds. Agave attenuata, or foxtail agave, is a soft, smooth-leaved agave that doesn't have the teeth and the sharp terminal spines of many agaves. It is a great plant for Southern California, especially along the coast. This is a very frost-tender succulent. Inland, where temperatures may drop below 32 degrees in the wintertime, is not the best place for these agaves right out in the open, unless you grow them as understory plants, where they will be protected by overhanging branches. And here you see Agave Ferdinand Regis. I don't know why this agave isn't used more often in landscapes, because it's just stunning, very easy to grow. It is related to Agave Victoria Reginae, but it actually gets bigger. This is Agave Vilmariniana. The common name is octopus agave, but it will get to 5 or 6 feet tall and about that in diameter. This is one of my favorites. It's Agave Blue Glow, and it only gets to about 18 inches in diameter over time. You can see how the leaf margins glow when they're backlit. This is Agave Perii Truncata, just a wonderful artichoke of a plant. Agave Bracteosa has this star-shaped growth pattern. The new leaves come out and create what looks like a star. Agave Americana is one of the largest of the agaves and of all succulents. It can get by in very poor soil, decomposed granite, clay, sandy soils. It doesn't care. Loves it if you'll pamper it and give it lots of water, but it will get by on rainfall alone. In Southern California, we get about, 12 to 15 inches of rain a year. That's all this plant needs. If you do plant it and irrigate it, it will grow faster, be lush and prolific, and it will pop, meaning up from its roots will sprout new little plants. Teeth along the leaf margins pressed into the flesh of the inner leaf, creating these indentations. Agave Americana marginata is gray-blue along the center of the leaves and has yellow along the leaf margins. Like its cousin, Agave Americana, it gets to be really big over time. Agave Americana, Mediopicta alba, or the tuxedo agave, is also one of the smaller of the Agave Americanas, only getting to about 3 or 4 feet in diameter and 2 or 3 feet tall. Agave Franzosini grows to be one of the largest of the agaves. This is actually a small one. It is about half the size that the plant will be when it gets bigger. This one is about 3 feet tall by 3 feet in diameter. Agave Franzosini has this wonderful blue-silver color. almost looks like tin foil. It's so silvery. The one downside to agaves is that they're monocarpic, meaning they bloom once and then die. So when you see an agave with a bloom spike, you know that that plant is toast. One of the reasons why Agave Americana got the name century plant is that it seemed like it took a century for the plants to bloom.
So that was a nice clip. You know, hopefully you got some notes on some of those agaves. And if you didn't, you can always look in the Sunset Western Garden book under agave, or just do an agave search on the internet to take a look at some of the agaves you might be interested in growing. They make wonderful potted plants, and they do quite well in the landscape as well. Now let's continue and take a look at a couple more species of agave. There's agave palmeri, Palmer's century plant, and that should be our next picture, number 13. Let's bring that up full screen. This is a large agave. Let's see, color is light green, yellowish pink. Well, that's the flower color, I'm sorry. It's flowers in the summer, leaves to 3.5 feet, flower stalks to 20 feet. Six segmented flowers are clustered atop towering flower stalks and have yellowish or reddish anther filaments and the scent of overripe fruit. The plant dies after flowering and setting seed. The leaves are usually solitary, non-suckering basal rosettes, and are glaucous bluish to greenish gray in color. Spine-like teeth along the edges of the leaves and tipped with a long, stout, dangerously sharp spine. Stabs with agave leaves can be quite painful and, yes, bloody. The nectar-filled flowers attract nectar-loving birds like orioles during the day and nectarivorous bats like the threatened Mexican long-tongued bat and the endangered lesser long-nosed bat during the night. Fun facts about a Palmer's agave is the largest native agave to the United States. Leaves used for fiber for hunting nets, baskets, rope, and sandals. Lifespan, 5 to 25 years, and of course not 100 years. Flower stalk can be up to 18 feet high. Stalks can grow up to 1 foot per day, easily grown by pups or seeds. Sharp spines contain steroid compounds, could cause localized swelling and discomfort. There is danger of Palmer's agave being overcollected for the bootleg mezcal industry in northern Mexico and reduced populations in southeast Arizona due to development. Mezcal is Spanish for agave. Mezcal pits date back to at least 8,000 years. A waxy coating with a powdery surface seals the leaf against evaporation. It's actually transpiration, and also reflects up to 75% of incoming heat. It practices CAM photosynthesis, and CAM is Crassula acid metabolism, which allows desert plants to conserve water. It's a special metabolic process. They depend on bats for cross-pollination. The flowers smell like rotten meat, which is attractive scent to bats, grow on tall stalks, and secrete nectar peaking between 8 and 10 p.m. when bats are most active. Nectar is high in proteins and sugars that most bats need for fuel. Have a shallow but extensive root system which harvests moisture from rain, dew, and condensation. And the waxy coating allows the leaves to roll moisture down the leaves to the roots. So, this is a wonderful, and that's Palmer's agave. Now, agave perii, which you saw in the video clip, known as Perry's agave or mezcal agave, is a slow-growing agave native to Arizona, New Mexico, and northern Mexico. The leaves are gray-green. Let's bring up that next picture, is number 14. The leaves are gray-green and have a spine at the tip. One of the distinguishing features is that the point on the tip, which is typically dark tan, brown, or black, is darker than the leaf. Indentations of the previous leaves show on the back of each leaf. The Huacha variety grows in a rosette pattern as large as 2.5 feet in diameter. Because of its compact size, plus its low water use and low maintenance, Perry's agave is considered a good landscaping plant for desert residential landscaping, requires full sun, hardy to roughly -5 degrees Fahrenheit, and that's really cold. Though there are reports of specimens surviving temperatures of -20 degrees Fahrenheit, Perry's agave is evergreen, aged agave. I don't know why we bother to say it's evergreen. Certainly none of the agaves are deciduous. Aged agave produce a 12-foot stalk with bright yellow blooms. Then they die after blooming as all leaf and root resources are put into the stalk. It can be propagated by either offset or seed. So this is a particularly pretty one, really blue and really, really nice. And these are aloes all around here. Those are all aloes. And this is an agave, that's an aloe. So they go well together, by the way, even though they're, because they have the same water requirements, the same requirements for habitat. Now, the next one is agave tequiliana, commonly called blue agave. Is an important economic product of Jalisco, Mexico, due to its role as the base ingredient in tequila. The high production of sugars, mostly in the form of fructose, in the core of this plant is the most important characteristic of the plant, making it suitable for preparation for alcoholic beverages. The tequila agave is a native of Jalisco, Mexico. The plant favors high altitudes of more than 1,500 meters. That would be about 4,500 feet. Grows in rich sandy soils. While commercial and wild agaves have different life cycles, both grow into large succulents with spiky, fleshy leaves that can reach over 2 meters in height. Agaves sprout a stalk when about 5 years old and that grow an additional 5 meters and are topped with yellow flowers. This stalk is cut off from commercial plants so that the plant can put more energy into the heart. The flowers are pollinated by native bat and produce several thousand seeds per plant. The plant then dies. The shoots on commercial plants are removed when they're about a year old to allow the heart to grow larger. The plants are often reproduced by planting these shoots. This has led to a considerable loss of genetic diversity. It is rare for one kept as a houseplant to flower, but a 50-year-old blue agave in Boston grew a 10-meter stalk, requiring a hole in the greenhouse roof and flowered in the summer of 2006. Tequila production is produced by removing the heart, the piña, of the plant in its 12th year. Harvested piñas normally weigh between 80 to 200 pounds. This heart is stripped of its leaves and heated to remove the sap, which is fermented and distilled. Other beverages like mezcal and pulque are also produced from blue and other agaves by different methods. There is a disease that's a problem as agave's production has moved to an industrial scale since the end of the 1980s. Diseases and pests, referred to as Tristeza y Muerte de Agave, wilting and death of agave, have hit the crop. Through the 1990s, diseases spread, particularly Fusarium fungi and Erwinia bacteria, exacerbated by the low genetic diversity of the agave plant. Other problems include the agave weevil, which is a big problem, and the fungus Thalaviopsis. And this isn't unusual. A lot of times you go out into the wild and you'll find plants growing out and they're widely distributed and they have tremendous genetic diversity. So they're not all uniformly susceptible to any particular pest. And then you decide you're going to turn this into a commercial crop and you grow acres and acres of it. And typically you select one of those plants from the wild with desirable characteristics, but you may very well have selected something with high susceptibility to a disease that you didn't even know existed. And that happened with jojoba, which is a desert plant, and the seeds are used for oil. And everyone thought jojoba. You go out to the desert, you find a jojoba, and you don't find anything wrong with them. They're all perfectly healthy. And so, you know, everyone thought, oh, well, it must not have any pests or any diseases. Well, then you grow them fairly close together, far closer together than they occur in the wild. You grow thousands of them. You pick, you propagate them probably from one selection or a limited selection. So you have low genetic diversity and then you group them all together in a big population. And what do you know? There is a pest. There is a disease. There's something wrong with them. And that's what happened to agave tequiliana. So other diseases or pathogens that can affect agave tequiliana Erwinia cartavera, that's a common, Erwinia is a bacteria, and cartavera causes a soft rot. Pseudomonas, and of course, Flaviopsis would cause a decay, a black leaf spot. So not something that you'd have to worry about, particularly if you grew one of those, grew an agave tequiliana as a landscape ornamental. Now the next agave is Augustifolia, and let's take a look at that one. This is another one of the ones with very sharp tips. This is called the Caribbean agave, native to Mexico and Central America, used to make mezcal and also as an ornamental, particularly the cultivar Marginata. I'll bring this up full screen, and this is the Marginata variety. You can see the edges of the leaves are striped in white. So let's see what else we know about this plant. Has a narrow, stiffly erect leaves with moderately spaced spines producing capsules, not bulbiferous. Whereas A. vivipara is described as having shorter recurved leaves with short spaced spines and bulbiferous. So this is Augustifolia. Let's now move on and talk about, let's see if I have any other, no, let's talk about aloe striata. Oh no, now we're moving to aloes. Yes, we are moving to aloes. So if we're going to talk about aloes, we need to talk about them because they are really quite different. Although they look the same, they're from different parts of the world, and they are not in the same family, and they have different flowers. And aloes don't die after they bloom. They are not monocarpic. There are about 500 species of aloe, and probably the most famous is aloe vera. And aloe vera means true aloe. The funny thing is, no one knows exactly where the natural distribution of aloe vera is. They are widely propagated and easily available, but there are no wild populations. The genus is native to Africa and is common in South Africa's Cape Province, the mountains of tropical Africa, and neighboring areas such as Madagascar, the Arabian Peninsula, and the islands off Africa. The family is called the Xanthothoraceae, a subfamily Asphoroidaceae. These aren't easy to pronounce sometimes. In the past, it has also been assigned to families Aloaceae and Liliaceae, members of the closely allied genera Gasteria, Haworthia, and Nepholia, which have a similar mode of growth, are also popularly known as aloes, but they are not really aloes. And it depends. I say aloe, but it correctly pronounced, it would actually be aloe, but aloe is fine. The plant Agave Americana, which is sometimes called American aloe, belongs, of course, to the agave genus. Most aloe species have a rosette of large, thick, fleshy leaves. Let's bring up this picture, and it looks a lot like an agave, but it's an aloe. This is aloe striata. The leaves are often lance-shaped with a sharp apex and spiny margin. Aloe flowers are tubular, frequently yellow, orange, pink, or red, and are borne densely clustered and pendant at the apex of simple or branched leafless stems. Many species of aloe appear to be stemless, with the rosette growing directly at ground level. Other varieties may have branched or unbranched stem from which the fleshy leaves spring. They vary in color from gray to bright green and sometimes striped or mottled. Some aloes native to South Africa are arborescent, which means they look like they are small trees, or in fact, large trees. Historical uses of various aloe species by humans is well documented. Documentation of the clinical effectiveness is available, although relatively limited. Of the 500 species of aloe, only a few were used traditionally as herbal medicine. Aloe vera, again being the most commonly used version of aloe in herbal medicine. Now, agaves are not used as in herbal medicine. In fact, agaves will almost certainly be toxic. And aloes being, you know, you can eat agave. You can eat aloes. You cannot eat agaves. Aloe perii, found in the northwestern Africa, and aloe ferox, found in South Africa. The Greeks and the Romans used aloe vera to treat wounds, and that is a common, it's very common to use aloe vera. You break off the leaves and you rub it on your skin to treat rashes and burns. Very effective. In the Middle Ages, the yellowest liquid found inside the leaves was favored as a purgative, which means, well, you know what that means, actually. Unprocessed aloe that contains aloin is generally used as a laxative, whereas processed aloe vera juice does not usually contain significant aloin. If it did, it wouldn't be very pleasant. So let's take a look at some species. Let's take a look, bring aloe striata back up. This is the coral aloe. It is about 18 inches tall by about 2 feet wide with rosettes of few flat, broad, pale green leaves that vary in color depending on the amount of sunlight. In hot, full sun, the foliage is pinkish, and in cool spots, they are often bluish green. The leaves are notable dark, the leaves have notable dark, narrow lines running longitudinally, although more pronounced on the subspecies Carasperginensis, are toothless. Now, if you see the edge of the leaf here, there's no teeth. There's no teeth on the edges. That's important. A lot of times when you'll see this sold, aloe striata, if it has teeth, it's a hybrid. It's not really striata. And they hybridize easily, by the way. So the leaves are toothless, pale reddish, nearly transparent leaf margins. In late winter and into early spring, emerge up to three two-foot tall stems that branch and hold clusters of coral red flowers. This plant is often sold as a solitary plant, but will slowly produce new rosettes at the base to form a cluster. Plant in full sun to light shade in well-drained soil and irrigate little to regularly, though quite tolerant of dry conditions. A plumper plant can be attained with regular irrigation. Hardy to 20 to 25 degrees Fahrenheit, plant in groups or as solitary specimen in the ground or a large container. Widely distributed in dry areas of the eastern and western Cape provinces of South Africa, growing from 800 to 7,300 feet in elevation. The specific epithet, striata, is from the Latin adjective striatum, meaning grooved or striped, in allusion to the longitudinal stripes of the leaves. Be wary of imposters. Much of what is sold as aloe striata in the nursery trade is actually an aloe striata hybrid. We have grown aloe has been grown since 1982 by this particular nursery that I have got these notes from. Their plants are grown from well-maintained and isolated stock plants that yield seed of consistent, uniform, and true type plants of aloe striata. Let's take a look at our next aloe, which is aloe patricula. And this one is in full bloom. And this what's really nice about aloes is they bloom every year for you and then they don't die. And they bloom much faster than agaves. This is at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. This aloe patricula is native to South Africa, specifically, I'll never pronounce it, Mpumalanga. Aloe patricula belongs to the aloe genus in the Xanthoraceae and is commonly known as a stone aloe. This particular aloe is a flowering species with unique and distinct inflorescences, which make the plant easy to identify and distinguish from other aloes. Very popular for gardening because of its beautiful and radiant colors. Like many aloe species, it is used for medical purposes as it aids in healing wounds and minor burns. Many of the aloes are similar to aloe vera in that way. This plant reaches anywhere from 18 to 24 inches in height and can reach a little over a meter in width. Inflorescences can reach about 4 feet. Surpassing height of the plant's fleshy leaves, this succulent plant is virtually stemless and has rosettes of blue-green colored leaves. Their inflorescences are tightly packed with dark brown anthers and typically include at least two colors, usually a deep red towards the top where the buds are seen, and cream yellow color at the bottom towards the base reaching the stem of the flower. And that's typical of a lot of aloes, is when the flowers are first opening, they're red, and then if you go to lower down the stem, the older blooms that open first, they'll be partially yellow or fully yellow. I see we have a caller. Let's go to our caller. Terry, calling from Pasadena, you're on the air.
Yeah, I had a question about my jacaranda tree.
Okay.
I have it, it has a few blooms on it, but it doesn't look well. I mean, it looks like it might be dying, and I wonder what kind of diseases do they get or these trees?
Well, jacarandas are a deciduous tree. But they don't follow the typical pattern of most deciduous trees, at least not here in Southern California, probably not anywhere where they're grown. They typically hold their foliage throughout the winter, but then start to drop it in the spring. And then they will look very poor in the spring. When all the other deciduous trees are leafing out in March and April, jacarandas are dropping their foliage, and a lot of times people mistakenly believe that they're diseased or dying. Then they typically bloom in June with no leaves on them. Now, there's a lot of variation. They may start to bloom and then right away start to grow new leaves, but they do look very poor in the spring months. They look like they're dying, but in fact, they're just going dormant. And then they typically bloom with their blue flowers in June, usually the first week of June, although this year it appears that they're blooming about a month or maybe even 6 weeks early because we had a very, very warm winter. We didn't have very much cold weather, any significant cold weather throughout the winter months. And so now we're seeing a very early bloom on the jacarandas and a lot of other little things that are going on because of we had a warm winter. But I doubt, no, your tree's probably not sick. It's probably doing what it naturally does, dropping its leaves in the spring and getting ready to bloom. And like I said, I've seen them in full bloom already. And here we are at the end of April, and it shouldn't really be blooming for another, well, 4 to 6 weeks. I've seen them up in fact, about 2 weeks ago, I saw them in full bloom up in Santa Barbara, which was quite surprising to see them blooming so early. They're typically blooming the first week of June. No, it's probably just natural. It's not sick.
Oh, okay. Well, that relieves my mind. Now I don't have to get it cut down.
No, don't cut it down. After it blooms, it'll break all new growth. I have seen them killed by armillaria root rot or the oak root rot fungus, but that not very often. I think it has good resistance. Probably doesn't need to be watered as much as people water them, probably once a month in the spring and the fall, every couple weeks in the summer. But often they're in lawns and they're getting watered frequently, and that's probably where you would run into a problem if you are in an area that is prone or has armillaria present.
Okay. Well, watch it then. Okay, well, thank you for the information.
Okay,
I enjoy your show.
Thank you for calling. Thank you for watching the
All
show.
Right.
So, we have a little video clip on aloes, and also I've shown this clip before, but I'm going to show it again because they talk about aloes in this clip as well as talking about cycads. This clip is from the Lotus Land up by Santa Barbara, and they have a wide collection of aloes as well as cycads, really appropriate plant materials, both. Groups, cycads, and we talked about cycads in previous shows. They don't need a lot of water. They do quite well in Southern California. Full sun, become large plants, become foundation plants in your garden. So if you choose to grow aloes, you can mix them with cycads, you can mix them with agaves, and euphorbias. All those have similar water needs. This is really important when you're planting a garden, is to select plants in an area of your garden or for that area of the garden that have similar water needs. You certainly don't want to be growing aloes and agaves next to fuchsias and ferns or even rose bushes because roses are going to need to be watered early spring, maybe just once a month or every 2 weeks. But as you get into the heat of the summer, August, September, you're going to be watering once a week. Perhaps if we get over a heat wave, 105 in the Pasadena area, the San Fernando Valley, you might be watering them twice a week. Well, if you're growing aloes and agaves, they don't need that kind of water. You could water them once a month throughout the spring, and then in the hottest part of the summer, you may go every 2 weeks, but that's probably not even necessary. You probably do every 3 weeks. Well, let's take a look at our next video clip. This is our second clip from the Southwest Parks and Gardens on Lotus Land. Let's take a look at this clip.
We're here today at Ganawaska Lotus Land in Santa Barbara, California. Virginia Hayes shows us this spectacular garden. Virginia, how did this garden become established and what's its purpose?
Well, we're here basically because Ganawaska, who created most of what you see around us, decided to grow a garden and then leave it for the rest of us to enjoy. Mm-hmm. There's an older history here. It was a nursery for a number of years in the 1880s. And then it was just a private estate, but Ganawalska owned it for over 40 years and created the gardens that we're going to see today.
I see a beautiful water feature here.
Yes, this pond was actually here in the 1920s, but Madame Walska did her particular touch to things, which was to dramatize everything and added all the shell features.
And around it, we've got plants which don't use a lot of water. We see aloes here.
That's right. This is the aloe garden.
And these aloes are from what part of the world? They're not from this part.
Most aloes are from South Africa and a few from Madagascar and other parts of Africa. Our collection is mainly from South Africa with a few Madagascans.
It's really dramatic. I like this one. It looks like a tongue.
Yes, this is called Aloe plicatilis. If you look at the way the leaves fold together, it's sort of like a braid.
Ah, okay. And then everyone's familiar with the aloe vera.
That's right.
And you've got some of that here.
We do have that, not right where we are, but the interesting thing is that most of these succulent aloes have the same medicinal properties that aloe vera is famed for.
I didn't know that.
They are not hardy, probably below 20 degrees. They may survive a few hours in the 20s, but we're essentially frost-free here.
So much of the Southwest can actually grow these then. I've seen them in Phoenix and Tucson.
Mm-hmm.
But we get into the higher desert, it's going to get too cold, so they're houseplants here.
Right.
Good medicinal houseplants, though.
That's right.
There's another tall one right there.
Yes. This is Aloe spectabilis.
That's beautiful.
And it is spectacular.
It is. They're trees.
Exactly. And they get much larger, actually, in their native habitats than they would here.
And these I like. They're nice mound formers. They're kind of nice green here.
Aloe brevifolia.
Oh, that's spectacular. And I understand you've got a world-famous garden with other plants in it here as well.
That's right. We have an amazing cycad collection.
That's something we ought to see.
Okay.
Cycad. Now, the sago palm is a cycad, but it's really not a palm, is it?
Right. It's one of the 10 or 11 genera in the cycad family that they look like palms a little bit.
A little bit. Over here, we've got fan palms, but I've seen a lot of palms that look like these cycads.
Right.
And so it's easy to see that they're confused. And I see they've got cones on them.
Right. They don't have flowers. They evolved long before flowers came on the scene.
So they're more like a pine tree.
Exactly.
Than a palm.
Exactly. The interesting thing about them is that they have male cones on male plants and female cones on female plants.
Okay.
Normally where they grow, the pollination to produce seeds on those female cones would be done by little insects.
And this is really here as a scientific collection now, isn't it?
Well, it started, of course, as one of Madame's collections just for visual impact, which it certainly has.
It does.
But because she was able to get these plants so many years ago in the 60s and 70s, she was able to amass a pretty impressive collection of all the genera that grow throughout the world.
We just moved into a bunch of blue ones.
Yes. These are adapted for desert climates in Africa and show off that blue coloration that's often seen in those kind of plants.
And over the other side is really green but tall.
Yes. A lot of these actually grow in sort of understory of a forest. Mm-hmm. And this one grew in South Africa in the forests and is now extinct in the wild. These are some of the offspring of the last plants that were removed over 100 years ago.
That's part of your scientific work then, to actually propagate these and hopefully preserve the germplasm.
Exactly. These, unfortunately, are all male. We don't have females of that species.
So you can't do, and you have to hand pollinate, don't you?
Right, right.
Look at the cone on that. That's spectacular.
Yes.
You've only showed us two.
So, that's Lotus Land. It's a private garden. You need to contact them and get an appointment in order to go through it. I hate to admit, I've never visited Lotus Land up in the Santa Barbara area with a famous, world-famous collection of cycads and aloes. So, but if you really want to see a fabulous collection of aloes, one of the best collections is at Huntington Botanical Gardens, and in fact, the Arboretum has an excellent collection of aloes as well. Let's take a look at some more aloes and see what we got here. Let's see, Aloe patricula. Let's go to our next picture, which is Aloe patricula. We were talking about patricula, but let's go back to that. Number 19, let's move on to our next picture, which actually is a close-up of the flower, and it'll show you what I was talking about. Bring that up full screen, because this will show you that the top, you know, is quite orange or red, and the bottom, the flowers become yellow. So when they're just still flower buds and they haven't opened, they're red. Now, our next species that we want to talk about is actually a tree aloe, Aloe ferox, the Cape aloe, Bitter aloe, Red aloe, Tape aloe. It has a bunch of common names. It is a CITES plant. It is listed on the plant list of endangered plants. Can grow up to 10 feet in height and can be found on rocky hills, in grassy areas, and on the edges of the karoo. The plants may differ physically from area to area due to local conditions. Its leaves are thick and fleshy, arranged in rosettes, and have reddish-brown spines on the margins with smaller spines on the upper and lower surfaces. Its flowers are orange or red and stand between 2 and 4 feet above the leaves. So really quite spectacular when it blooms. And the leaves dry, the lower leaves, and here is the inflorescence. So this is all probably photographed at the Los Angeles County Arboretum, where they have an excellent collection. Our next one is Aloe rubrovillacea, and this is native to the Arabian Peninsula, occurring in the mountain chain that parallels the Red Sea coast. It is found both in Yemen and in the adjacent part of southwestern Saudi Arabia. In nature, it grows in steep places and has a pendant for semi-pendant growth habit. However, it has done well at the Ruth Bancroft Garden in Walnut Creek on level ground, with stems creeping along the ground as they elongate over time. And if we take a look at the flower, is 22. And this is a typical aloe flower. The name rubrovillacea means red violet and refers to the purplish coloration taken on by the leaves in sunny situations. Offshoots from the base arise occasionally so that in time a clump is formed. Plants flower in the winter, beginning in November or December. There is a sometimes second flowering in summer, but not nearly so many flower spikes as are produced in the winter. The flower spikes may be single or with one or two branches and are topped by dense clusters of attractive red flowers. Although the plants themselves are quite cold tolerant, and turning temperatures down to 20 degrees, the flowers can be damaged whenever freezing temperatures occur. That's not unusual. Flowers are often far more tender than the leaves in many plants. And not a problem in the Bay Area, but it can cause trouble in interior valleys like Walnut Creek and when winter temperatures are quite low. So this will do, if we have a cold snap in the San Gabriel Valley, you may get some damage to the flowers during the winter. Our next one is Aloe marlothii, known as the mountain aloe or the flat-flowered aloe. This is a large tree-like aloe, single-stemmed, Southern African, known from rocky places. If we bring up Aloe marlothii, which would be number 23, bring that up full screen. This is a really spectacular aloe, occasionally growing to 6 meters tall. That would be about 18 feet. Distribution ranges from the Klip River Hills in Johannesburg through eastern Botswana, northwards over the South Spansburg to Zimbabwe and Malawi, and eastwards through Swaziland and Mozambique to the coast. This species grades through intermediate forms into Aloe spectabilis, and the two are now considered synonymous. Named after Rudolf Marloth, the renowned South African botanist, this species is in full flower, presents a magnificent spectacle. The trunk densely covered by withered old leaves, which when green can be up to 1.5 meters in length, and usually densely covered in short spines on the convex lower surfaces and less so on the concave upper surfaces. I don't know if you can see it, but the leaves are covered with spines and the flowers are yellow. Their inflorescence is much branched panicle with up to 30 or exceptionally 50 racemes, ranging in color from yellow through orange to bright red. Flowering color is through the winter months, and as is the case with most aloes. And there are natural hybrids with some 30 or more subspecies. Now our next one, let's take a look at our number 24. It's a little better picture of this. And you can see, it looks bumpy in the picture, but those are actually spines. And then here's the racemes. You can count them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's probably 20 or more racemes on each plant, and they are tree aloes. And a lot of people don't realize that aloes can be trees. Aloe. Now let's talk about our next one, which is aloe arborescence. That's our next photograph and showing it in bloom. Commonly known as the Krantz aloe, which is shares with the well-known and studied aloe vera plant. This species is also relatively popular among gardeners and has recently been studied for possible medical uses. It is the only other member of the aloe family that is claimed to be as effective as aloe vera for medical purposes. Let's bring that up, leave that up full screen. I want to point out a couple things. Even though it's called arborescence, which would make you think it's a tree aloe, it's more like a shrub. So it's clumping. You can see it makes a big clump. And it has, you know, it flowers all over the place, puts on a big show. Large, multi-headed, sprawling succulent. It is its specific name indicating that it sometimes reaches tree size. Typical height for this species is 2 to 3 meters. Its leaves are succulent and green with a slight blue tint. Leaves are armed with small spikes along the edges and are arranged in rosettes. Flowers are arranged in a type of inflorescence called a raceme. The racemes are not branched, but 2 to several can sprout from each rosette. Endemic to the southeastern part of southern Africa, specifically, this range includes the countries of South Africa, Malawi, Mozambique, and Zimbabwe. It has the third largest distribution among the aloe genus. Although it has adapted to many different habitats, its natural habitat usually consists of mountainous areas, including rocky outcrops and exposed ridges. Commonly known as the Krantz aloe and refers to the Africanus word Krantz, which means a rocky cliff. Our next is aloe aristata, which is a small aloe, also known as the torch plant. Let's take a look at this. This one will do better. Well, you can grow it in the ground, but often grown in a pot. That's number 26 is our next picture. This species is indigenous to South Africa and surrounding countries. It is stemless, sawtoothed, and succulent. Rich nectar, its nectar-rich flowers tend to attract birds, bees, and wasps easily. When not in bloom, it is similar to and often confused with Haworthia fasciata. Let's see if we can get number 26 up. It looks quite a bit like a Haworthia, but it is in fact an aloe. Commonly called cereali, meaning the slippery one, also lace aloe or torch aloe. It is one of a group of called dwarf aloes, which have extremely small rosettes of usually incurved leaves. The leaf surfaces are marked by small white tuberculate bumps, and the leaf margins are armed by soft white teeth. This species typically produces flowers in the month of November, and its range includes eastern and western Cape provinces of South Africa, the Orange Free State, and now just called Free State, Lesotho, and KwaZulu-Natal. They are stemless and usually occur in groups of up to a dozen or so rosettes. The inflorescences are branched and the flowers are dull red to pinkish. And let's see if we can get that picture up because it's a nice aloe. Aloe aristata, number 26. There it is. Let's bring that up full screen. This looks very much like a Haworthia, very similar. And you can see all these little white bumps. And it's a very small aloe compared to many of the aloes we've looked at. And if we look at it in flower, is 27. Bring that up full screen as well. And you can see the typical aloe bloom. There we go. And so good sized plant right there, but they don't, you know, it's only a foot or two across. And it's got one spike that's branching like that. Really nice aloe. And does, usually I see it in pots more than I see it in landscapes. Now our next one is aloe variegata, and this is known as the tiger aloe or the partridge-breasted aloe, indigenous to South Africa and Namibia. Plants grow to around 20 to 30 centimeters, that's 10 to 15 inches, with 18 to 24 leaves arranged in 3 ranks. New leaves appear individually over time from the center of the plant, flattening older leaves and pushing them outward in a spiral fashion. This is one of my favorite aloes. It's really, really, you can see why it's called a tiger aloe, because it kind of has stripes. each leaf is a rich green color with irregular light green banding made up of amalgamated, slightly raised oval spots and similarly light-colored fine serrations along each edge. In mature plants, the outer and thus oldest leaves are 10 to 15 centimeters long, 3 to 6 centimeters broad at the base. Depending on trauma, space, water availability, and even old age, outer leaves will die off, turning golden brown and shriveling away, which most aloes do. They really shrivel their old leaves. Plants reach maturity in 3 to 7 years, again, largely dependent on the space, sunlight, and water available, at which point they will begin to send out racemes of flowers. Flowers develop in a cluster at the head of the raceme and are spaced out by its rapid growth. Our next picture shows it in bloom, aloe variegata, number 29. The flowers are oranged. This one is just, you know, here are the flower spikes. There's another one. Unfortunately, they're not open, but they are orange, arranged in a raceme around 20 to 30 centimeters in height. The flowers in March and April, with offsets being readily formed. In South Africa, this aloe is found in the arid areas of Western Cape, Eastern Cape, Northern Cape, and Free State. It generally grows in rocky terrain. And our next one is aloe vera, probably the most famous of all aloes. Probably originated in northern Africa, the species does not have any naturally occurring populations, although close related aloes do occur in northern Africa. The species is frequently cited as being used in herbal medicine since the beginning of the first century AD. Extracts from aloe vera are widely used in cosmetics and alternative medicine, being marketed as variously having rejuvenating, healing, or soothing properties. There is, however, little scientific evidence of the effectiveness or safety of aloe vera extracts for either cosmetic or medicinal purposes, and what positive evidence is available is frequently contradicted by other studies. Medical use of aloe vera are being investigated as well, although it's well known to be an effective treatment for burns and rashes. Aloe vera is a stemless or very short-stemmed succulent plant growing to 24 to 39 inches tall, spreading by offsets. The leaves are thick and fleshy, green to gray-green with some varieties, showing white flecks on the upper and lower stem surfaces. The margin of the leaf is serrated and has small white teeth. The flowers are produced in summer on a spike of up to 35 inches tall, each flower being pendulous with a yellow tubular corolla. Like all aloe species, aloe vera forms abscisular mycorrhizae, a symbiosis that allows the plant to better use mineral nutrients. The species has a number of synonyms, aloe barbadensis, aloe indica, aloe perfoliata. So common names include Chinese aloe, Indian aloe, true aloe, Barbados aloe. The actual specific epithet, vera, means true or genuine. In folk medicine, aloe vera has a long association. Although it is not known when its medical applications were first suspected, early records of aloe vera use appear in the 16th century BC in a variety of publications. And now Pliny the Elder's Natural History mentions aloe vera, which was published in the first century, and along with Juliana and Cissa Codex produced in 512 AD. The species is used widely in traditional herbal medicine in China, Japan, Russia, United States, and many other countries. Aloin, a compound found in the exudate of some aloe species, was commonly ingredient in over-the-counter laxative products in the United States prior to 2003, when the Food and Drug Administration ruled that aloin was a class 3 ingredient, thereby banning its use. Aloe vera has potential toxicity, with side effects occurring at some dose levels, both when ingested or applied topically. So you should take it with a grain of salt as to whether you want to eat this. And if you do eat it in with, well, think about it, how much you want to eat. You know, don't be eating the whole plant. A 2-year national toxicology program study on oral consumption of non-decolorized whole leaf extract found evidence of carcinogenic activity in male and female rats. I don't think it's a problem. A lot of people eat this, and if it were really toxic, we'd have been hearing a lot of problems. Now, our next one is aloe banzii. Well, let's take a look at some more aloe veras before we move on. Number 31, bring this up full screen. And aloe vera always has yellow flowers. There's no red in it at all. So this is aloe vera. You can tell just by the yellow flowers. And here's a close-up of the aloe vera flower. This is our next picture. So other species of aloe, typically the top is red and the bottoms turn yellow, but this is always yellow. And then, let's see. Let's take a look at our next picture, aloe aculeata, which is another typical aloe, but if you take a look, you can see that the tops of the flowers are nice and red or orangish, and the bottoms are yellow. That really adds to this striking effect in the landscape. Let's take a look at our next close-up of the actual flowers, aloe aculeata flower. So they're really striking, really, really pretty. And here's our another picture, aloe X principis. This is a hybrid, number 35. All these pictures were taken at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. Take a look at our close-up aloe principis flower, number 36. So they're really quite striking when they bloom. Now, our next aloe is the largest of all the aloes, Aloe bangzii, known as the tree aloe, native to South Africa. It is native climbs. This slow-growing tree can reach up to 54 feet in height and 3 feet in stem diameter. Aloe bangzii, also known as barberry, is Africa's largest aloe. The tree aloe is often used as an ornamental, of course. Its tubular flowers are rose pink, green-tipped. It flowers in winter, and in its natural environment is pollinated by sunbirds. First discovered by Mary Elizabeth Barber, and that's why it's called aloe barberry, who was a plant collector in the former Transkei. She sent specimens of the plant and flowers to the Royal Botanic Gardens at Kew, where it was named by Robert Allen Dyer in 1874. In her honor. Subsequently, it was also found in KwaZulu-Natal by the well-known traveler and explorer and painter Thomas Baines in 1873. He also sent a specimen to Kew, where it was named Aloe bangzii. And in fact, if you go around to a lot of the gardens, you'll see this labeled as Aloe bangzii. Although known as A. bangzii for many years, Aloe barberry was the name first given to this plant and takes precedent. So this is a spectacular one, and there are some huge ones at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, and they're probably well over 100 years old. The distribution of this it is subtropical coastal forests, ravines and dry valleys in the eastern regions of southern Africa, widely distributed from Eastern Cape through the former Transkei, KwaZulu-Natal, Swaziland, and northwards to Mozambique and East Africa. Another large tree aloe is Aloe dichotoma. And bring that up full screen. You can see how large it really is, quite big. Known as the quiver tree or corker broom, indigenous to South Africa, specifically the North Cape region and Namibia. There are three subspecies recognized, subspecies dichotoma, subspecies palanzii, and subspecies raminosaba. These have also been treated as three separate species over time when they are grouped within, all inhabit the same arid areas of the Richveld and the Namibia desert. Around the South African-Namibian border, treated as separate species, the three have been given different ratings as being vulnerable, critically endangered, or endangered. The three subspecies can be distinguished, but you probably can't find them. I would just, if you're looking for this and want to grow it, just buy it by species. I see we have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. And Gordon, calling from Los Angeles. You're on the air.
Hi, Jerry.
How you doing?
Good, thanks. I have sent an email and I didn't get a reply, so I was told it was probably not received. So I thought I'd give a call to see if you can help me. I'm referring to the cactus show that you had. I had a cactus that's folded with the spine along the ridge. The unique thing, and it's column. It's in a column. It grows in a column.
Oh, okay.
The thing about it is that it had a corkscrew growth pattern going clockwise. I wonder, A, if you know the name or a place I might be able to get it. I'm having a lot of trouble with your transmission here on cable, and I didn't get the name of that grower, wholesaler. Is it a wholesaler in Tucson?
Well, the best place to get a cactus identified would be the Huntington Botanical Gardens. There's a couple ways you can go about that. You could either email me a photograph of your cactus, and I'll pass it on to either Kathy Musial or John Traeger. Kathy is the curator of living collections at the Huntington Botanical Gardens and is like a walking encyclopedia of plants. And John Traeger is the curator for the indoor collection and is really has vast experience, really an expert on cactus. You might just be able to email them a photograph. If you go to the Huntington Botanical Garden website, you ought to be able to email to either of them from the website. If you click on staff, go down and look for Kathy's name, Kathy Musial, or John Traeger, and take a picture of your cactus and email it to them. Attach it to your email as a JPEG, and then email it to them and ask them if they recognize your cactus. Highly likely they do. The other option, how big a plant is it?
Well, it's been a while since I had it.
Oh, okay.
It got overwatered, and it's that's why I'm trying to replace it.
Okay. Well, you know, there is the Cactus and Succulent Show is coming up, I believe, next month at the Arboretum. Where are you? You're in L.A.?
Right.
Well, I would absolutely go to the Cactus and Succulent Show, or go on the internet and look for the website for the California Cactus and Succulent Society, because they meet every month. And then you could go to one of their meetings, and they usually at these meetings, they'll have plants for sale, or they have plants they trade. People bring in cuttings, people will root cuttings. You know, they trade plants. That's one of the joys of joining a plant group, like the Rose Group, or joining a Cactus and Succulent Society, or just attending their meetings. It's not so much. I doubt if they even have dues to be members. It's just all a bunch of people who love cactus and succulents. And then when you go to their shows, the things you'll see there are just knock your socks off. They're just people who grow these fabulous cactus, and they baby them, and they take care of them, they bring them, and they win a little ribbon for having the biggest or the prettiest or whatever categories they award their ribbons for. But the real joy is that you get to trade plants with people. And some of these things are so unusual and so rare, you know, maybe there aren't any nurseries propagating and growing them. So if you go and look for the plant, it's hard to find. Now, there's a couple of nurseries that really specialize in cactus. One is the California Cactus Center on Rosemead in Pasadena. And it grew in a spiral fashion like this?
It grew in a spiral fashion clockwise, and the ribs moved with it and just in a column form.
That's hard to... hard to pin down in my head. Maybe somebody else. You don't have any pictures?
I don't even have the plant.
Well, maybe at one point you took a picture before it went down on you.
I wish.
But if you go to the cactus show, you might see the plant.
Well,
or if you
hopefully.
Go to a nursery, you look through and see if you spot the plant that you lost. That's a good way to try and figure it out. Other than that, you might just email Kathy or John at the Huntington and describe the growth and see if they've got a guess at what it might be. John Traeger especially, I'm trying to think of the other curator. There's a second curator at the Huntington who's in charge of the Desert Garden. They have two curators at the Huntington who work with the desert and the succulents and the cactus. One, John Traeger, is in charge of the indoor collection, And their other curator, and his name escapes me right now, I should know it because he actually was guest on the show one time, and John also. And he is in charge of the cactus garden, or the desert garden, because it's not just cactus. It includes aloes, agaves, euphorbias, and a lot of cactus. So that's my best guess to assist you, and I can look into it a little bit, but just growing in a spiral fashion, it's hard to say. That's not something that really rings a bell with me to a specific genus or a species.
Mm. Okay, well, I'll give them a shot. Now, I have one other question, if I could. I have a clump bamboo growing in a pot. It's been in the pot for a while, and I would like to repot it. It's in a large container. What are the steps one takes to do that?
Well, how big is the pot right now?
Well, at least 3 feet tall.
So about a 15-gallon pot?
I'm a lot larger than that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And you want to put it in an even bigger pot?
I want to divide it.
Oh, you want to divide it?
I want to divide it and then, you know, split it in half or something, because it doesn't seem to be putting out any new growth for a couple of years. It isn't dying, it's just not regenerating.
Well, you know, when you're dealing with large plants like that, and, you know, it's in a large pot already, you might want to get someone to help you because they're heavy. I would use a very sharp knife or hand shears, pull it out of the pot, lay it on its side, try and find a natural division in the middle of the pot, if you can. Sometimes you got to kind of move it a little bit and look for a place where you can just split it right down the middle. You want to use a nice sharp knife or sharp shears, you know, just split it down the middle. Get yourself a nice, large pot. They can be fairly, if you buy really quality pots, especially the glazed ceramics that are really attractive and really nice in a landscape, or, you know, if you have a nice yard and you want to, if you're just using black plastic pots, you know, those are kind of nursery pots. They're not very pretty. If you go get a nice glazed ceramic pot, they can be, you know, $100 or even more, especially the large ones, the big ones. Then you want to go ahead and, you know, I would get a potting soil, and that should be plenty. You don't need to, you know, amend it or change it. Just get a potting soil rather than a planter mix. Planting mixes are meant to be put in the soil. Potting mixes are meant for pots. And it shouldn't be, it should actually, you know, really take off if you repot it. I've seen this a lot. Plants that get a little root bound and they've been in a pot a long time, and they're not really thriving anymore. They're not sending up a lot of new shoots, or they're not, you know, depending on the plant material you're talking about, they're not flowering like they used to. And then you repot them, and bam, they take off as soon as you repot them. So it's a good idea to repot your plant, but it's probably a little bit heavy, and you might want to have somebody assist you.
Okay. So there's no time frame or
spring would be a good time. Early spring, if you get to it now, I would avoid it in the middle of the summer. Either do it now or maybe postpone it until the fall.
All right.
But don't do it in August or September.
Okay.
That's probably the worst time to replant pots, is in the heat of the summer.
Okay.
Because it's a little stressful, of course, to take the plant out of the pot, I should say, and cut it in half and repot it. You might want to then leave it in the shade maybe for a week or two. Give it a chance to grow a few roots before you move it out back out into the full sun.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. I enjoy your program.
Okay, well, thank you for calling, and thank you for watching the show. Yeah, in general, you know, and I've experienced this with a lot of my plants. I've got a lot of plants, as you might guess. And I've, you know, I have a number of orchids that I grow, particularly with the orchids. When I repot them into fresh orchid bark, all of a sudden, bam, they take off again, they start growing. I didn't bring in a plant that I forgot to bring in this morning, which was one of the Malaysian rhododendrons. Really, really pretty flowers. But when I got those plants, they seemed to just be sitting there and not growing well and not taking off. So I repotted them all into a much bigger, you know, a little bit bigger pots with fresh peat, because they're rhododendrons, you want an acid soil. So I used a lot of peat moss. And boom, they put on new growth, and now bam, they're flowering. So repotting old plants in old pots is really a good idea. Here's a question from Rudy. Do you know of a landscaping company that can do water-efficient plants and design in Los Angeles? Well, I would think any competent landscape designer in Southern California should be focusing on water-efficient plants. Any of them, if they're not doing that, if they're still giving you what I call English garden design, which is lots of grass, ferns and azaleas and roses and a lot of stuff that requires a lot of water, then they're really, you know, behind the curve, because everybody should be working on that right now. I don't know of any specific companies that I would recommend right off the bat. There are some, actually, depending on where you are, I know that the California Cactus Center on Rosemead in Pasadena does have design people, and they can help you design a landscape that's very efficient. And in general, what I'll tell you is you're going to grow, if you got your front yard with your lawn out away from the house, you know, closer to the street, you're going to want to grow some low-growing materials, things like, ice plants. There's a whole bunch of different genera of ice plants. Maybe Diamondia, very popular ground cover right now. And then as you get closer to the house, you might grow some low-growing aloes or agaves. And then as you get closer to the house, you're going to have some taller materials. You could think about using cycads. You could think about using the taller or larger aloes or agaves, or euphorbias. So those are the kind of things. And in fact, I wanted to briefly talk about, that's a great question, what other kinds of plants can you be considering? You could come up with a plant list. It's very easy nowadays for everyone to access a lot of information. And particularly what I want to mention are members of the Crassulaceae. Now the Crassula family, the name genus is Crassula, and there are about 300 species of Crassula. And a lot of them make good ground covers or small drought-tolerant small plants, maybe 6 to 12 inches tall. So you start off with the real low stuff, you go to some bigger stuff, you go to the tallest stuff at the very back up against the house. That's typical. You don't want your tall stuff too far out front. It blocks the view of the garden. So you can go with Crassulas. Another genus is Sedum. Sedums, there's a lot of good ground covers in the Sedum genus. And then the other genus, Echeveria, and I have an Echeveria right here. Here's an Echeveria. Maybe we go, and often, you know, a lot of these plants grow in rosettes, very thick, fleshy leaves. They'll take full sun. They send off offshoots from the base. This is, a lot of the Echeverias are referred to as chickens and hens. There's a couple of different species that they call chickens and hens, because this is the chicken, and you get the little offshoots at the base that look like, you know, they're much smaller, so they call it chickens and hens. So that's Echeveria. That's a great genus. The other one that is really popular are, of course, the Aeoniums. And let me just show you a few of the Aeoniums. Here's an Aeonium. This one will get a little darker in the full sun. This one is a branching Aeonium. Now, a lot of these Aeoniums don't naturally branch. You can see the stem gets taller and taller. So what you need to do is cut it off, and then this easily roots. Just stick it in a pot, let it dry off and harden off a little bit for a week or so. Stick it in a pot, and it'll grow, and then it'll send up, it'll branch. Now this one here naturally branches, and this is Aeonium lindii, native to the Canary Islands. Many of the Aeoniums are actually native to the Canary Islands. And then, now this one here, this is another really excellent material as a ground cover. Let me just show you this one. This has actually become very popular. You're seeing it all over the place now. This is called blue chalk. It's a Senecio. And it's actually, I believe, in the, let me just look it up before I say something completely wrong. But it is in the genus Senecio. And let me just look up Senecio real quick. And I'm almost there. Come on. Senecio. And this is Senecio mandrillaceae. It's called blue chalk. Most people just call this blue chalk. It is in, believe it or not, the sunflower family. And you wouldn't think that within the sunflower family they've got succulents, but they do. And most of the other Senecios aren't succulent like this. But this one, if you notice, it's already trying to grow roots all along the stem. Very easy to propagate. And if I were to stick this in the ground and just lay it on the ground, it'll root along the length. You often see this in big clumps as a ground cover. So the best idea for Rudy is not only to seek out a good designer, but also to become familiar with the various plant materials that people are using in dry landscapes right now. So that's my suggestion. You might go in and visit that nursery on Rosemead in Pasadena, the California Cactus Center, and talk to them. Ask them how much they would charge to design your garden and perhaps even install it. Some of these materials are not cheap, by the way. It's not cheap. Some of these very slow-growing plant materials, once they get big, they want a lot of money for them. So be patient and buy smaller plants, and you'll save yourself a few dollars. Now, let's see. We're running out of time a little bit. And let me just, since we had that question about designing a nice garden, let's take a look at our fourth video. And we're going to skip the third video, and we're going to take a quick look at this fourth video. Well, maybe we shouldn't do that one. Let's go to number five, our last one, Aeonium arboreum atropurpureum. We're just going to see this for a couple minutes. I want to show you the use of these aeoniums in the landscape. If we can go to our last video, number five, which is on our list, because we're running out of time. We're just going to show 2 to 3 minutes of this video. I just want to show you what this aeonium looks like in the landscape, give you an idea of how to landscape with it. Let's see if we can go to this video real quick.
This plant is Aeonium arboreum atropurpureum, and this is a group of plants that are succulent perennials native to the Canary Islands. And right here, I'm just going to show you the typical flower. This is not for this plant, but it's from the plant family, and I'll give you a good look at this brilliant yellow flower that's typical of this plant. So these have a very, very distinctive look to them, as you can see here. You're looking at a mature planting in Carmel, California. This is about 5 feet wide by 3 feet tall. And what's distinctive about this family of plants, the aeoniums, is the leaf heads that you see here that look like flowers. And they're really just the way the foliage is presented. And at the terminal end of each stem is this very unique floret of leaves. And in this case, you see this nice burgundy color with kind of a green center. And just so you know, there is some dust on this particular plant because it's next to a dusty parking area. And so there's a little haze there that you wouldn't naturally see it having a deeper color. So these, they're really used for me in design as a specimen shrub or perennial. And as this one has been used, it's just a standalone. It's like a piece of sculpture almost. This entire plant, I'd say it's probably a grouping of two or three, but these stems can also root. And I believe that's what's happened here. Either they planted a small grouping of them, or the stems, as they kind of laid out, started to root. And you also see branching happening within the plant itself. Most of the aeoniums send up single branches, but if my understanding is that you can cut these, and below the cut you're going to get 2 to 3 divisions, and that's one of the ways when they're younger to get some fuller appearance to the habit. So the thing about these in design is they're not very cold hardy.
Okay, I just wanted to show you kind of how that aeonium looks in a mature clump looks in the landscape. And you see those are only about maybe 12 inches high. And if they get a little too tall, you cut them off and they'll send up multiple heads. But the one thing he said was they were florets. They're not florets, they're rosettes. Florets would be flowers. Now let's take a look at this aloe because we're running out of time. I wanted to show you a few aloes I brought in. I forgot to bring them in my aloe plicatalis, which is one of my favorite aloes. But this is the Aloe congolensis, the Congo aloe. And this is going to be a small shrub-like aloe, native to the Congo, forms tallish rosettes of succulent, shiny, green leaves with translucent green. Let's see how tall it's going to get. It doesn't say how tall it's going to get, but I would say about 3 feet tall. So this is something you'd grow, you know, on the edges of your garden with lower stuff in the middle or in the front. And then our other aloe is right here. I only brought in a couple aloes, actually living plants. This is Aloe California. This is a hybrid aloe. And this is, forms tallish, loose rosettes of lanceolate blue-green leaves with translucent green teeth. Excellent for borders, rock gardens, hardy to 36 degrees. So that's a little bit tender. I'm surprised it only hardy to 36 degrees. That would worry me that I would freeze and I might lose it. But so that's another aloe. Let me see if I can get that to stand up there. Now let's see. We've got just a few minutes left, and let's take a look. There are a couple problems that we get on aloes, and let's take a look at number 39. This is the aloe mite. And the aloe mite doesn't go to all aloes. It just goes to a few. Bring this up full screen. But if you see this on your aloe, you see this galling, this growth here. Now this is probably one that might have been, you know, this could be Barbadensis, or it could be one of the other clumping aloes, not one of the tree aloes. I've never seen this on Aloe plicatalis, or some of these, the two aloes I just showed you probably don't get it. But these small aloes, they're stemless, they grow right on the ground. Aloe striata, Aloe barbadensis, Aloe arborescens may get it. But this is a mite. It's an areophyted mite, and it causes galling. And let's take a look at our next picture, which is, again, the aloe mite. Bring that up full screen. So you can see here how distorted and screwed up that is. Unfortunately, if you get this, you should just tear out the whole plant. There's no control for it. It's just going to be a disaster for you. Now, a lot of people might confuse a few other things with aloes, and particularly the yuccas. Our next picture is the Joshua tree. And let's take a look at our Joshua tree. Bring this up full screen. This is Yucca brevifolia, and it is a native to California, Arizona, Utah, and Nevada. And it is confined mostly to the Mojave Desert, and it thrives in open grasslands of Queen Valley and Lost Horse Valley and Joshua Tree National Park. There are two subspecies. And our next picture is Yucca whippelae. I just want to show you that. We've got 1 minute left. Bring that up real quick. Yucca whippelae is the Spanish sword, or our Lord's candle is the common name. Bring that up full screen real quick. These are monocarpic. They flower and die. It usually takes about 7 years. It's not an aloe. It's not a agave. It's a yucca. And so anyway, I just wanted to show you that before we go, because they're so pretty and they're starting to bloom real soon. You should be seeing them bloom up in the foothills. But we'll be back next week where we'll talk about roses. I want to thank everybody who helped us working in the control room for their hard work to put the show on, and everyone who called. We'll see you next Sunday, which will be our last broadcast of this semester, and then we'll be back in the fall. See you then.